It's so good to have you here.
Thank you for inviting me here. I'm very, very happy to be here. I was here yesterday and it was wonderful, and I came with my sister and we learned a lot. I love the talk about psychedelics. I'm into it. And there's a lot of doctors here I need to talk to.
Good, good. Well, we generally don't have funny people here. It's just kind of a policy, but
well,
we decided
don't get your hopes up.
We decided to break that policy. And so it's really thank you. Thank you for coming. And yes.
Thank you.
So you have been through some changes recently. There was a previous book you wrote called Are You There, Vodka? It's Me, Chelsea. And now you're at Wisdom 2.0. So life has taken its own curves and twists. And I'm wondering what initiated this new kind of path. You left your TV show that was very successful, and you're moving into areas that you probably didn't think you were going to move into.
No, I never thought I would be here. But I had a very hard time. There was an election a few years ago, and I had a very difficult time with that. Mm-hmm. And to me, it represented the world being completely out of control and unhinged. And I needed to talk to a professional. So the man who was standing here earlier, Dan Siegel, is my psychiatrist. Mm-hmm. And I had interviewed
him. You've got good taste.
Thank you. Yes, I know, right? And I interviewed him on my talk show. And then after the election, when I realized I was really struggling and I couldn't deal with, you know, I was acting like a spoiled baby. Something had gotten wrong. I'm like, wait, adults are supposed to take care of politics. What's going on? How could something so terrible have happened, you know, and I was acting out like a child, and I had such high outrage. So I called Dan and I sat down with him and bitched about Donald Trump for the first three sessions and then eventually got real about what Donald Trump represented to me, which was my childhood and being unhinged and my brother dying when I was 9 years old and my family kind of falling apart and all of us retreating into our own corners. So for me, it was, I had to really just kind of really get self-involved. I always thought therapy was navel-gazing and I, you know, it's enough about me. I have a show after me. My books have my name in them. It's like enough talking about myself. So I was resistant to go. And when I really sat down and got real about what my issues were and why I've been moving so fast in my life for so long without the ability to sit down and think and be still with my pain and admit that I was in pain, you know, I needed to unwrap that.
Wow,
so
that's huge.
So it was a lot of really, like, you know, not heavy. It is heavy lifting because it's cathartic. It's painful. It's, you know, it's embarrassing. You know, I didn't want to cry in front of anybody for my entire life. My brother died and I shut down. Like, no more talking about it. Let's not discuss it ever. So for me, therapy really opened my eyes, and I started to realize that if I really wanted to contribute to society in a meaningful way, then I needed to fix my own injuries.
Wow, that's beautiful. That's beautiful. Thank you. And I'm curious, what did Dan do or say that allowed that door to open? Did he corner you? Did he use some special...
No, he did not corner me. he was very patient with me. You know, I was kind of testing him out. I had been to therapy. I'm sure everyone here has tried it or in one way or another. You know, I had been to therapy many times, but I was never honest with myself. I thought I was doing fine. My career was great. Sure. I was making tons of money. I was able to take care of my friends and family and go on great trips. And, you know, and that's not the meaning of life. And, you know, I was measuring my success in the wrong way. So he was just very patient with me and obviously knew I was there to get something real out of it. And then, you know, I write about, and I ended up writing, my whole book is about my therapy with Dan because it just was such an awakening to me. You know, and one day I just came in there and he handed me an orange that he had picked from his tree at home and said, here. And I was like, oh, I don't even eat carbs. Has this guy been listening to me at all? And plus it was room temperature, another thing I hate about fruit.
It's acidic, it's sugar.
What are you doing? But I was, you know, trying to be polite, so I was trying to peel it, which I wasn't really. And in that moment, I guess the gesture in itself just had me unravel. And I just was like, I was peeling the orange and I was crying and I was like, I hate oranges. And And I was like, I need to tell you about the day my brother died. I need to tell you what my brother said to me. He said he was going to come back, and he never came back. And like those words were like so seared so deeply inside of me to actually say it out loud for the first time. Obviously, it's still so painful for me because it was just like I had never told anybody that what my brother had said to me. My brother, you know, said he was going to come back. Don't worry, I won't leave you with these people, meaning my parents. He was like, you know, and there were six of us, so we had a great big family. And he went hiking in the Grand Tetons. He died. He fell off a cliff and died. And my 9-year-old brain took that as rejection. It took that as my brother didn't go off and have an accident. My brother rejected me, found a family he liked better and a sister he liked better, and he's never coming back.
Yeah.
So my entire life with relation to men, because that was ultimately my first crush, my oldest brother, you know, with men was that, was I can't trust you. I have to be fierce, I have to be strong, and I have to be independent because you cannot rely on any single person in this world. And, you know, getting that off your chest is is huge. So
Thank you. Thank you. It's interesting, as that trauma happens, there's these agreements, I think, that we make of like, life, I'm not going to have that happen again, and therefore I'm not going to trust because I don't want to have that experience. And at some point, that's useful or understandable, and yet at some point, that also becomes inhibiting. And it's heartwarming to know, because I think some people are like, well, I'm so old, I you know, or I'm 40 or I'm 50, and yet when that opening happens, it allows that. It doesn't take that away, but it allows that experience to kind of like get expressed. How would you explain what happens when you're able to tell that story to a compassionate listener?
Well, first, it helps that you're paying somebody. You know what I mean? Because it's an exchange. I didn't want to burden anybody with my pain. I didn't want anyone to have to deal with me because I was the strong one in my family, in my work, in my job. I've always been a leader. And so to admit that, you know, I thought strength was strength. I didn't know that vulnerability is strength. Yeah. I didn't know that crying is strong. Like being brave is crying and letting people see you. And for me, that was a huge lesson. You know, I never thought I would meditate. I meditated 25 minutes this morning. I mean, I don't know if I'm doing it right, but but I know now that if I keep, Dan was like, you just commit to 3 months. I'm like, 3 months? I could be dead in 3 months. I can't commit to anything for 3 months. But I have committed it to 3 months. And every morning I get up and I do 10 minutes, and it's not a lot, but it's for me. I'm waiting for it to click. You know, sometimes I feel a little click, and sometimes I feel like I'm not doing it right, and I don't know what I'm doing, and it's a waste of time, and I want it to be over. But the important thing is to habituate. Is
who feels that when they meditate sometimes? Yeah, so you're in good company.
Oh, great. Oh, that's excellent.
So there's a pull towards something, and you're getting a sense of the possibility, and it's still really, really hard. And how do you feel with that grief? Does it feel completed, or how do you feel like that process is happening of opening up that door?
It explains a lot, you know. It explains a lot about my behavior and about my, you know, the way I've conducted myself in my life and gone through life like, you know, a speed bullet train, just looking for every opportunity, being rewarded for my bad behavior, for talking about, you know, drug and alcohol use on camera and people loving it, and, you know, getting a book deal about writing about my one-night stands. Like, I was just constantly rewarded for all of this behavior that I thought was like, oh yeah, that's so me. And it's like, no, that's a defense mechanism. That's you because you were a little girl, like trapped in a grown woman's body and had a lot to undo. So I feel, you know, there's a bit of an identity crisis, you know, to have to drop what you do professionally and what you're known for is very hard.
Yeah, particularly when that gets a lot of attention and praise.
And, you know, and I had to really think about what I wanted to do moving forward, which was campaign for candidates for the midterms, which we had a huge success with, and so many people devoted their time and energy to. So I was very proud to be a part of that.
Women in particular. Women candidates in particular,
We have 127 women working in Congress this year, so, awesome. And it's just about kind of really just, you know, I wrote it down because I brought it to Dan. I go, I think I'm going to have to write a book about this because that's my, I overshare and that's my thing. And are you going to be cool with that? And so I gave it to him and, you know, he had some corrections, of course. But
did you explain the wheel and different things?
Oh, yeah, the wheel's in there. Okay, don't you worry. If you guys need a second round of that, it's in my book. But it was just an incredible experience. I was with the right person at the right time, and I took advantage of it, and I did the responsible thing, and I had just went every time. You know, sometimes you don't want to go to therapy.
Sure,
sometimes
sure.
You don't feel like crying, and I'm like, fuck, not this again, you know? Especially in the mornings, because I'd go into work and look like I got in a fight with a snow cone. My face was just red. Every day, I'm like, don't cry, don't cry. And then finally, like, I'm just going to start crying right now because...
Yeah.
But I'm happier, you know what I mean? I'm calmer. I don't talk as much. Uh-huh. You know? It's just nice to listen more and not start talking because someone else stops.
Yeah. That's huge. That's huge. Well, I appreciate you coming and talking with us. And I definitely think there's talking that's about what's true and what's heartful, and then there's talking just to fill space. And I think often in our culture, we talk to fill space, and it creates it takes a lot of work and a lot of energy. And I think the speaking that you've spoken with us today that's from the heart, I feel like I get nourished by. So I appreciate, I see you using your gift of voice in a different way. And it's such a sweetness to see somebody who came from the world that you lived in and being willing to let that unravel so that some other part of you has space to move out. And that you, when you look out at the world, what I hear is that it's not just about you anymore. When Dan talked about the Mui, it's about getting people elected, women elected into Congress. It's about doing a Netflix show on white privilege. Like there's this greater sense of belonging versus just something that props you up higher and higher. Is that how you would describe it, or how do you see that process?
Yeah, I would describe it as getting out of my own lane. You know, you get success and you want more and more and you get offers and everybody's kind of grabbing at you and you want to make, you want to do it all. You want to say yes to everything and you want to like, and you want to, you know, you want to keep being successful and the momentum builds and the momentum builds and it's, you're missing it all. You know, there's so many moments that I just went right through that I should have been more present for, that I should have been more mindful for. Yeah. And now I feel like I can, you know, I feel like I'm at a place where I can take in much more and I can give out much more. Not to be out, you know, when I say be in your own lane, not to just be out for yourself. You know, there are so many people who are so worried about their lives or who are raising three children. Luckily, I didn't do that, but I don't, you know, who they don't have time to think about everybody else. Yeah. They're just trying to pay their bills, you know, and they're just trying to get something going. So it's easy for all of us all to get wrapped up in our own stuff.
Sure.
And without having children and without having, a husband, I do have the ability to help so many more people.
Yeah.
So that is what I want to do. I want to actually do stuff that has an impact instead of doing stuff that I just like to do.
Yeah. Thank you. And could you say a little bit about why white privilege? It's not something white people generally like to talk about.
Yes, I found that out.
And you want to do a Netflix show on it. So how did that emerge as part of how you can use your voice?
Well, this was part and parcel with the book. I think the book and the documentary, this what I'm doing this year, they're kind of very linked together because it's both personal. I mean, obviously, I can't do a documentary about white privilege commenting. I mean, it has to be, it's a white person's problem. So I wanted to kind of use my own privilege to show, for a long time, I thought I was really talented. And, you know, I may be, but that's not why I'm successful. Mm-hmm. I had a lot going for me, and one of those things was being white and pretty and having a big mouth. You know, that a black woman wouldn't have been rewarded for that necessarily at the time that I was.
Yeah.
So I had to really take a look at that and look around and see, okay, what is it? What is the difference? You know, we don't really take the time to look at what happens to other people and what their lives are like and the struggles that they go through. You know, it becomes very, centric. Like we're always in our own back pocket. And for me, I really wanted to get a better understanding of how to be a better white person to people of color. Yeah. How can I do better? And how can I make a movie showing us all like the little things we can do? There's no big aha moment, right. Like, okay, well, this is gonna fix everything, but it's every single day, you know, a lot of what's been talked about at this conference, it's being mindful and looking somebody in the eye and listening to their story and saying, oh, you're from a different place, I'm interested in you. Right. I don't know anybody that in your culture. Let me spend more time with somebody, you know, from a culture I know nothing about and educate myself so that I am a better advocate and ally to any group that is marginalized in this country.
Beautiful, beautiful. Thank you. Thank you. And how is your response from Hollywood or the media world been? Like, are they like, Chelsea, have you gone crazy? Or they're like, Chelsea, welcome? Or has it been mixed? Have you lost friends? Have you gained friends?
Yeah, I've lost a lot of friends. I mean, over time, not because of this. But yeah, people are maybe too. No, people were irritated after the election. I was very loud, and people were really annoyed by that. But I didn't care because I knew that it was wrong. What was happening was wrong and icky and terrible, stain on our history. But as far as, you know, I've always wanted to be involved in stuff. I'm not a conflict avoider. I like conflict. Mm-hmm. I'm interested in it. So, you know, I don't care. I like to stand up, you know, I like to stick my neck out, and the sentence I hate the most is like, I don't want to get involved, you know, I hate when people say that. I don't get it. How could you not want to be involved? Mm-hmm. So, I mean, I've had my own manager going, you're going to kill your career, you're going to kill your career. I'm like, thanks a lot, buddy. I'm trying to, like, you know, save democracy here. What do you mean I'm going to kill my career? But, you know, you don't have to listen to that. People may think some things like that, but, like, you're in charge of your own destiny. Yeah. I'm in charge of my life. Yeah. And I'll tell you what's going to happen next, not you.
Yeah, beautiful, beautiful. And what would you say to that person out there who might feel that conflict? And I know we're all in different situations and not everybody has the choices that you might make or I might have. But what would you say about a person who's watching this or on the video who feels like, wow, I feel like I'm stuck in a box and I don't know how to get out of that box. And that box has been created through my whole life and through my whole story and through my pain. And I don't know where to go to best address that box so I can be more of my true self and true voice.
I think you go wherever you don't want to go. You know, right. I'm here. Like,
So you're saying that this is the last place on earth you want to go? No.
It was 5 years ago. Yeah. I would never have been at a mindfulness conference. I'd have been like, meditation, blah, blah. Like, no, I get it now. I'm awake. I get it. This is where it's at. So I understand that now. But I think whatever makes you uncomfortable, you go. You know, if you don't like dancing, go dance. If you don't want to go on a blind date, do it. If you don't want to go to, you know, open your brain up because there's so much to absorb and so much to learn. I mean, last night at our dinner, I met three people who I want to be friends with, you know, long term, like people that had great things to say. Like, this is a great group of people. The fact that you're spending your weekends trying to learn more about mindfulness and meditation is just incredible. Yeah. And so that's where it's at.
Yeah, beautiful. Thank you. And to follow that inclination and to not be driven by those fears is kind of what I'm hearing.
Oh, sorry. Okay. I didn't. Yeah, I went off on my own. once again.
It addressed part of it, but I also...
It is fear. I think it is fear. We all have our boxes that we're in, and I think you have to get out of... You have to force yourself to engage and interact with people that are going to give you something that you don't have.
Yeah.
You know, and to learn more, because that is all fear-based, you know?
Right.
And I think challenging your fear is one of the greatest things you can do in your life repeatedly. It never ends, because once you challenge something and you get past something, there's something else you're going to be scared of, or there's something else that's going to be challenging. But getting out of your own box is so important, because you know, you're in charge of your happiness.
Yeah. And do you feel like that what's going on politically in our country was at least part of your inspiration for that? That seeing the ways in which politics is working, it does seem like it's on one side more than the other side, but I also see it's on both sides, that there's like this egoic orientation that the political world and our leaders often embody. I think our current president way embodies it sometimes, but the Democrats also can be very, so how do we begin to shift that in a way that addresses the system and doesn't just kind of vilify one person because the next election, you know, it's like there's a system. How do we kind of begin to foster different soil that could grow leaders that actually reflect some of our better values? Do you have a sense of?
Well, I think this is a perfect example of doing just that. And I think what's happening in our culture, you know, we talk about those, we talked to the woman from Calm yesterday on mm-hmm. the stage, and there's Headspace, and those apps are the only, you hear everybody's on these apps now. Everybody's meditating. Like, there is a reaction to this presidency that is wonderful and beautiful. Mm-hmm. You know, there are communities and coalitions that have formed because people are stronger together, and they are figuring out ways to combat what we've been handed, you know, what happened in this election. And I think, you know, with climate change, so many independent people are doing more now than they ever were before because we can't rely on the government right now. So people are meditating more than ever because people feel out of control and they want to calm down. So there's all of these things that are like cross currents. So at the time that we have this terrible administration that doesn't care about our environment at all, we have individuals who are gathering and organizing and doing things and making their, you know, and making their carbon footprint smaller in their own home. And I think that's the power, you know, that's the power in something like, you know, in group meditation that we were doing earlier today. That is the power when we all get together and we all want the same result. Yeah. And that is stronger than any administration.
Beautiful. Thank you. And your book, you have a book coming out. So you have a Netflix show and a book coming out. Do you want to say anything about your book besides that feels gives us a bit of an introduction into what you're addressing there?
Well, it's called Life Will Be the Death of Me. I'm doing a like 20-city book tour where I will be interviewed by different people in each city. Different celebs, friends of mine are coming out to each city. It's basically an exploration about, you know, a lot of people died while I was writing my book, and I went into Dan one morning. I'm like, people are dropping like flies. Like, my father died this year, two of my dogs died. You know, we were just talking about my mother's death, and I was writing all this down. I'm like, this is going to be a big bummer, this book. It's all about, like, dying. I'm like, this, no one's going to read this. And then I was like, no, it's great, because, you know, I was able to inject it with my, you know, humor and my self-deprecation and my all my stories that I was so embarrassed to tell, to just put it out on paper and put it down and write it down and give it away.
Yeah.
And and then be like, all right, next thing, you know?
So
I'm not cooked, I'm not done, I'm not fixed. Yeah. But I'm a lot better than I was before.
Yeah, beautiful, beautiful. And I think what's really interesting is you have not lost your spunk. It was like all of a sudden you're pretending to be this cool meditator, whatever person. Like, you kept your passion.
I come out here, I'm like,
yeah,
totally over the top.
No, but you've kept your passion, and you're being yourself, and you're also coming from a place that's less traumatized, or that has a better understanding of the trauma that motivates us. And if I look at our culture and I look at what we need to learn, I feel like if we understood the trauma that then we later act out in life, which gets acted out by so much by our leaders and by us and families, like, if we can understand what those triggers are, we will act differently in the world because we're no longer trying to replay this one event. And so I feel like you telling your story about really understanding that, which we all experience, maybe not at that level, but some level of disappointment and of hurt and of trauma, that becomes the seed that then grows a different way of being. And so for me, you telling that story, and I'm sure you're doing it much more, like, there's people who will read Dan Siegel's book and Jack Kornfield's book and John Kazan's book, but they won't read those books, but they'll read your books, because they just feel like you understand them or your voice. And so I'm really glad that you've not lost your spunk and your energy and your voice as you've also transformed, and that you're willing to talk about the pain and the grief and continue to be, your loud, expressive voice, or however you describe it, to be a change maker in the world and to not give up. And that's a deep, that touches me a lot. And I'm wondering, we just have a few minutes left, is how would you like to end this time? Is there anything that you wished we would have covered that we haven't covered, or is there anything you want to say to the world that feels relevant right in this moment?
I'm feeling optimistic these days, even though things are pretty ugly in certain, you know, arenas. I'm feeling optimistic about what's in the future, you know, with the kids from Parkland, with the women elected to Congress, with the people of color representing our country to look, actually, you know, represent what this country looks like instead of old 76-year-old white men. No offense to any of you guys who are here. I've seen a few, but... I personally love old white guys. That's my wheelhouse.
Hey, that's our base here, so be careful.
Yeah. So I'll be careful. I won't say anything more. I think I just, that's it. I would like to leave with a sense of optimism. I love this togetherness. I love, you know, being able to be a real person and come to real events and talk to real people. It's been giving me a lot of fruit, and I'm really grateful for it.
Great. Is there anything we can do for you?
I don't think so, but I'll think about it and get back to you. But there's nothing you can do for me, but thank you.
Well, I think one thing I would like to do, and this is both for you, but just in general, is to notice those places where we're uncomfortable and to begin to take small steps towards them. And whether that discomfort is a conversation about race, or that discomfort is a conversation about what's going on in our families, or that conversation is about something that's going on in work, is if we can all begin to kind of take that and begin to lean into those experiences and be with you in that journey. And I know a lot of us are already doing that, but to me that would be something. I will try and do that better as my offering, and I would invite us all to kind of take that piece and extend it, because I feel like that's the movement that you're also wanting to ignite, and I want us all to be joined in that movement.
Thank
you. Am I making any sense at all?
Sort of, yes. Yes, definitely. I think that's beautiful. Thank you.
Yeah. So thank you so much, Chelsea, for joining us
thank
and going
you.
Where
thank you,
to
Wisdom 2.0.